Hello, hello. Welcome back to another episode of the Flying Cat Marketing Interview Series. I'm super excited to have Lauren Lang on today. She's a brand and content strategist in B2B SaaS and senior content marketing manager at Constructor, an AI platform that creates personalized e-commerce experiences for large retailers. Today, we're going to be talking about the cross-functional role of content in an organization, and maybe especially a B2B organization. Hey, Lauren, how's it going?
Hey, Maiva, it's great. Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
Absolutely. I've been wanting to get you on. I'm really happy that we're here to talk about this today because I think it's a very important topic, a misunderstood topic. So let's dive in. You are pretty opinionated on what role content plays in an organization. So walk me through it.
I think that's a fair assessment probably. So there's this old saying that we all know, which is like content is king. And my feeling on that is let's not get too much like into our heads on that. I think that content really acts in service of the business. So the business is king, right? And the goals that the business is trying to achieve are king. But Anne Handley, rock star that she is, she has this great analogy that I love, which is like from The Lion King, that content is everything the light touches, is her analogy. And I love that. If you look at it that way, content isn't king, but content is the kingdom. And it's really this connective tissue, this glue that connects all of the marketing functions. And it at least touches most of the different business functions too. So if we look at different marketing functions, like in this, I think of them vertically, like, so different like channels are sort of vertical in my mind, and different business functions are almost like vertical, right? If you look at org charts, you know, the different functions are like in this vertical sense. Content is one of the very few things that cuts horizontally across.
Yeah.
And that's because every business function exists for a reason and plays a part in the brand's mission and in the story we tell about that mission and our place in the market. So some examples are like, how are we going to tell users about a new product? I'm currently working on a product launch right now, so that's very top of mind for me. But how can we create excitement about our company being a great place to work for future employees? How are we going to articulate our brand vision or our unique positioning that sets us apart from everyone else? How can we leverage our SMEs, who are these brilliant technical minds, to build trust and authority in our industry? And especially in B2B, how do we help and empower people to do better at their jobs, both as a product and as a brand? Yeah. So all of these questions are content questions. If content is mismanaged or not done effectively, none of the positive business outcomes that those questions are trying to get at will occur, or at least not to the extent that they could. But on the flip side, if content works and all of the processes that support that content work, then content has this ability to have a huge impact, not just in marketing, but across the business and the brand as a whole.
I love that. Seems a little challenging if you are a small content team and they say your responsibility is content. And if you're thinking about it in this cross-functional role saying, okay, I am responsible for the content of all of the departments in the business. How do you know what to prioritize?
Yeah, it's really difficult. I think there's certain things that need to occur before content can happen. So there is this prioritization that happens. And yes, we're probably like having to create a certain number of pieces of content every quarter. But I'm really a strong advocate of doing a lot of the foundational work first that's going to make that content creation easier. And a lot of that is really this brand building, brand identity, positioning, almost product marketing type of work. And not every company has the resources or has invested in that function yet, especially at an early stage startup. So a lot of times that's really work that somebody needs to be doing it. And a lot of times that's work that I need to have done.
Yeah.
In order to do my job. And I'm looking around and no one else is doing it. it's the work, it has to be there. So it ends up being the work that I take on. And a lot of people are, you know, a lot of my clients and a lot of my coworkers at Constructor, it's work that everyone understands needs to be done, but it's just, it's more important work and not necessarily urgent. No one is, oh my gosh, we're up against this campaign or we're up against this deadline. We're trying to get a certain, you know, quota of leads, but we haven't done this brand building work. It's never going to, you know, so it's just, it's not urgent, but it's really important. And it's going to, what is going to set the stage for everything else.
It is urgent in a way, if it has an impact on everything else that you're doing.
It does. Yeah. I mean, I look at it from like that Eisenhower matrix of like you have urgent on one axis and important on the other. Yeah. And it's not urgent until all of a sudden it is urgent because you've been putting it off and things are not looking good because you have campaigns that are failing or not performing.
So you're saying it's content's role to do all of this, but it's interesting because if you go on LinkedIn or job board and you say, we're looking for content marketers, positioning, you know, building positioning and branding and those kind of things is not usually one of the skills you'd expect from a content marketer. You would expect that they know how to use that information to create relevant content, but to actually set that positioning and create all of that, it's a big ask, I think, for a lot of content marketers.
Yes and no. I think that if you are doing content marketing in a way where you are really doing a lot of audience research and you are putting together processes where you are trying to communicate very clear value propositions, I think a lot of that, I think honestly, content marketing being so cross-functional comes from that core audience research, which honestly is the underpinning of basically, it should be the underpinning of basically every business function, is that the classic sort of jobs to be done interviews and the, you know, the understanding what are the primary pain points and what are the potential solutions that my audience is looking for at this point, at this stage. And so I think that content marketing is very much aligned with product marketing or brand marketing in that they all begin with this sort of foundational research, or they should, right? Yeah, I don't think it's so totally, you know, out of left field. I think that for people who are just beginning in content marketing and they are learning, they're beginning as content writers, yes, there's probably a learning curve with that. But eventually, in order to write better blog posts, if you're going just from being a content writer and executing on a brief that you've been given to doing content strategy, all of a sudden, then there's a lot more overlap with a lot of different business functions. And that's really how I've gotten into a lot of these other business functions and have started contributing more at a more like high level strategic place, is from, you know, like advancing as a content marketer in my career and really starting to ask a lot of these questions. It's not just, oh, let me execute on this blog post. It's why are we writing this blog post?
Right.
And what is the function of this blog post? And how does this blog post play well with all of the other blog posts and all the other content that we have? Like, what's its specific function? And then you're just asking those critical questions along the entire process.
Is this something you taking this stance as I'm now cross-functional in my role as content? Is that something that when you got to Constructor, you said, listen, I'm not just going to be publishing blog posts or publishing LinkedIn posts. I'm going to be working with all of the departments. How did that come about?
Yeah, it's interesting because you mentioned about job roles or job descriptions, and being cross-functional was not necessarily in my job description, but we're an early stage startup still. We're Series A, so not like super early stage, but still a relatively early stage. We're still hiring and figuring out our approach to product marketing and doing all this. And we're a brand new marketing function at this company. Marketing really didn't exist in any department. Like, our marketing department is less than 6 months old, which is really fun because there's a ton of opportunity to build the plane as you're flying it and to build the processes that you want to see and build the marketing organization that you want to see, right, as it's going. So that's been awesome. But I think it was just identifying those gaps for me, is seeing, hey, here's a gap. Do we have a strategy around X, Y, and Z? Have we done a ton of like really deep competitive research, for example, and figured out, have we articulated really what our strategy is going to be to compete as a challenger brand with the market leader? Have we talked about this? Have we figured out? Because I need to know that, because I need to know how to write about it. And so it was just, no, we need to do that work. And so it's, okay, let's do that work. We can wait until we are hiring a product marketing function, or we can get started now, because we can do it. It's probably going to be not as super, a superstar strategy as when we bring on these fantastic product marketers, but we need somewhere to start. I need something to underpin what I'm writing, yes, because I don't just want to be writing words into the ether. I'm writing words for a purpose here, and I want them to land. So it's just roll up your sleeves and do the work, because the work needs to be done.
The work does need to be done. Do you ever get pushback from executives or saying, no, we need to, or get this done fast so that we can start publishing? We need to start publishing as quickly as possible. And how do you get that buy-in?
Yeah, the publishing is still occurring. And so that's happening, and we're scaling a content engine, and all of that is happening. But I've been really lucky in figuring out how to articulate what needs to be done, I think. And I've been probably pretty successful in articulating what needs to be done, but I've also been lucky in that the leadership at the company understands that this is work, yeah, that needs to be done. And it's a little bit of a shift. We're a sales sort of organization where you cannot engage with, or a B2B software solution, you can't use it until the sales conversation has, yeah, taken place. So it's not PLG or one of those things where it's like, hey, free trial. So there's been a lot of teamwork and collaboration that's actually had to happen in order to get everyone on the same page and have everyone understand where we're coming from and what we're trying to accomplish.
Yeah. So what should an org actually measure to see if content is successful? Because we do want to see ROI, yep, but if it's so cross-functional, the KPIs, are they different for each kind of content, or does content overall have its own KPIs, or how do you organize that?
Yeah, this is the question, right? It's hard. And I have two sort of different ways of looking at it. So the first is looking at the content from a qualitative and quantitative metric standpoint. The reality in our world is that attribution is just becoming more and more difficult. And I won't talk about the dark funnel too much, but we all know it's there, especially in B2B. And not only that, but there was just some really interesting research that was shared by Peter Weinberg, who's the head of the LinkedIn B2B Institute. And it shows that clicks have no measurably different impact on marketing outcomes than impressions. So even if you can do click attribution, a click is less likely to mean any more than all of the unattributed impressions that might be generating leads as well, which is just mind-blowing and goes against a lot of the way that we measure KPIs and measure success and measure attribution and all those things. Sure, you can evaluate content quantitatively against, you know, these KPIs to get a granular sense of how things are performing. I like to break up KPIs by the stage in the journey, right? So at top of funnel, blog post content, does it get a certain number of views? Is it having a decent time on the page? Is it channeling people to other parts of the site? That might be something I'd look for. If it's a research report that I'm publishing, is it getting downloaded? Does a low funnel landing page that's maybe with a CTA to book a demo, is that getting conversions? But that's not the whole picture, yeah, that quantitative look. So content also needs to be evaluated qualitatively. Does it resonate? Is it not only high quality, but is it unique? Does it ever get mentioned in sales calls as a great qualitative metric? Is it something that people in the company are excited to share with prospects and customers? This is a great question. Nick Rixmeyer on LinkedIn, he's a brilliant brand strategist I follow. And I actually don't know if his last name is pronounced Rixmeyer. I think it is. But when you're on LinkedIn, you never know how anybody's name is actually pronounced. So we're going to go with it. But he's been talking a lot lately about champagne outcomes, which are the big business OKRs that matter more than anything else. So do we see content marketing looking at it through my content marketing lens, do we see content making a difference in those outcomes? And the impact is going to be indirect. And we have to be okay with that. No one is going to purchase enterprise software because of a blog post.
Right.
Even one piece of enablement content isn't likely to make a huge difference in itself, no matter how low funnel it is. But are we contributing to the mission and opening up opportunities for conversation? Are we making it into the consideration set? Because I think that's how content can contribute to revenue and business goals. And that's it has a part to play in those champagne outcomes. So that's one way of looking at it. Then there's this whole other way, which is if content is the kingdom, if it's everything the light touches, and if content is acting in service of the business, then the business really should enable that content to succeed, because content success is going to be company success. So in terms of KPIs and OKRs, I really believe that content should have cross-functional OKRs if content is a cross-functional function. So for example, at Constructor, our product team has OKRs to help us create content by contributing thought leadership and by being available for interviews and even helping us write more technical pieces, which is just fantastic. Yes. I am so lucky to have that. But that just shows how much company buy-in there is. Other examples is if a certain number of case studies or pieces of customer marketing are OKRs, then maybe customer success teams should share responsibility in bringing those into the world. They should be making the process for doing those interviews potentially easier. And sales too. Sales should have OKRs potentially around enablement content or targeted ABM content, because they have the insight that will make that content more successful. And all of a sudden, if everyone is incentivized to participate in the content function, then you see like that just greases the wheels for everything to just run a lot more smoothly. And especially when content is going to be benefiting everyone in the long run, we're educating people on the product. So product should, you know, be excited about creating content. We're creating enablement content that's going to make sales jobs easier. They should be invested. So it really is sort of about that investment. And, you know, if we say that content is this horizontal function, if it's cutting across, then that really means it's cutting across. And at the end of the day, I am the responsible party as the content marketer, but as a company, we rise and fall together. And so I think that's something, you know, that's how I think one way that we can measure success.
I love that. So practically speaking, if you have OKRs for every department, are you dividing the content team, or is it still one team doing it all?
We are a small but mighty content team of two.
Okay.
Two and a half. I have a wonderful freelancer I work with as well, but we are a small content team. I see us growing organizationally. That's a wonderful question. And there are a bunch of potentially like different ways that we can look at this. I think it's going to be really interesting to see where content lives in our organization in the next few months to a year. Right now, we do what we can when we can. And it's actually really helpful to have those other OKRs cross-functionally, because it doesn't mean that the burden or the responsibility is totally 100% on my shoulders. It's like, you know, our product team just created this wonderful rough draft of a white paper. And so I'm going to run and I'm going to take it over the finish line, but it would have been totally impossible had they not written the initial draft of that. So having that help actually, or having those cross-functional OKRs actually helps some of the execution, just because it is a lot to do. Yeah. It's impossible to sort for one person to do everything, or even two people to do everything.
Do you ever find that since it's the OKRs of every department to contribute to content somehow, do you ever get too many cooks in the kitchen? You're the one who has oversight on this is the strategy, this is what we're going to do. And now you have every department saying, do this for content, make this piece, create that. How do you manage that?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think maybe I can just best illustrate this with like how it works.
Yes.
So for example, if you look at my recent Slack messages, you'd just be like, wow, Lauren gets around. There's probably not a business function at Constructor that I don't communicate with on a regular basis. So the product team, we had this white paper. Again, I can't say how lucky I am enough that they help me create content. But, you know, customer success, we're getting customers on board for case studies. We're tapping into our data science team to be subject matter experts for some more technical pieces we're creating. We even have gotten HR and people ops on board because my content specialist who works with me started this new initiative for onboarding new employees. And he created this little questionnaire that we can use to welcome them on our social feeds, which is awesome. It's great for showing off our company culture and potentially recruiting new team members. So all of those, we are definitely in the driver's seat for all of those, but it's the OKRs for everybody is in support of the content, which is in support of the business. But really, I think the best example that I have is my relationship right now with our sales team. So again, like we're an enterprise solution. Prospects need to speak to sales in order to move ahead with the product. A lot of my work lately has been identifying opportunities for enablement. And it really requires a collaborative approach. I'll tell you like a lesson that I learned. A few months ago, the sales had been asking for a long time for sort of this competitive one-pager. So I mentioned we're a challenger brand. We're going up against the market leader. So we wanted a one-pager that really outlines what are our value props and how do we compete. It's just pure like positioning and, you know, awesome sales document. So it came at a great time. I had just had a huge win because I included a testimonial quote from a customer who mentioned the competitor by name and described the weakness in their solution. So it was like a total gold mine. It was like, here's somebody, we have a quote from someone who's somehow totally okay with us kind of ripping on the competitor in the form of their testimonial, right? So I was like, this is going to be great. This piece of content is going to just knock it out of the park. But in the process of creating it, I made a mistake. I unintentionally included some other information that actually could have hurt the sales conversation. Oh. And it could have opened the door to the competitor poking holes. And they tell me they need this competitor one paper, and I do it. And I get sign off from a number of high level folks at the company, but I didn't really talk to the sales team until I delivered it to them. And they were like, this is great, but I don't know. And they ended up not using it. They never used it. And for me, that's the opposite of what content should be doing. My content should be making the job easier.
Yeah.
And so it was just this incredible learning experience for me. It was like, listen, like, how can I make this never, ever happen again?
Yeah.
How can I never waste time and resources to create something that no one's going to use? So I completely just shifted my approach to this. So I've been involving my AEs, my account executives, through the process, not just at the beginning and the end. We have this jam session a couple months ago. We have a backlog of enablement ideas that are things that they specifically have said they need, which is great. Like, it's great to involve them in brainstorming. But then I also partner with them throughout the drafting process and make sure that they have eyes on any draft of like my content before it goes to design. And I'm asking them, like, is there anything that looks off here? Is there anything that gives you pause? And really, more often than not, they actually get really excited about what's coming up. And they know it's built specifically for them. And they often like ping me when it's still in design going, hey, I have an account I'd love to use this for. Is it ready yet? Which is awesome. That's what I want to see. So I think there is a benefit to being highly collaborative.
Yeah.
When content exists in a silo, not only does it not resonate as much because it's not, you know, fulfilling business needs because I'm a space cadet and I didn't really consider like all of the things that, you know, sales might need to think about. But then also our sales team is much more likely to distribute content and find ways to use it when they have had a voice in creating it. And so it's not necessarily asking them extra work, but it's just having them as a voice in the process. And so coming back to your question about too many cooks in the kitchen and not doing marketing by committee, I think it's really important to be strategic.
Yeah.
So I like involving stakeholders at key points where there's still flexibility or where we still need clarity. So I talked a little bit earlier about doing jobs to be done for your customers. I also like doing like the jobs, having that jobs to be done mindset for my internal customers, right? What are they needing this piece of content for? And how can I help it meet those needs? And then that allows me to really tailor the piece to fit the business need. And And then when our sales team feels that their needs are being met and that this content is actually going to help them, then there is less back and forth. Everyone's busy. Everyone has their own goals. No one is trying to sit in my content and itty-bitty nitpicky changes. I think they're really excited to have content that's going to really help them. And I am too. Everyone's excited. We're aligned, which just feels great.
Congratulations, because not every company gets to that point.
Right.
Yeah. Right. That's really good. Lauren, this has been such a pleasure talking to you today. Thank you for joining me. If people want to talk more to you, I know LinkedIn is a great place. Is there anywhere else they should connect with you?
Yeah, I'm on LinkedIn, I'm on Twitter, and I have a personal website, which is just laurenlang.com.
Excellent.
I'm happy to meet people there too. Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much, Lauren.
Maiva, thank you so much for having me. This was so fun.
Absolutely. And if you are watching or listening to this episode, please remember to give it a like, leave a comment, and share with a friend or colleague. Thanks, and see you next time.